And the doctor said, you know, I've got the right thing for you. I've had a bunch of medications. And then the first thing is, first thing is, you have all these symptoms. And they were like, that's really nice, doctor. I'm going to go home and ask first thing to have a doctor to switch them. And then you find out, it's not just a dream, it's a real problem. You're just dealing with the symptoms. You're having the symptoms out until your body heals this thing. But if you're worried, maybe you do that at first time sometimes in the body of Christ. We have an issue, and we deal with the symptoms that we have to lose. Have you ever wondered why we quote those scriptures and follow them forward and they put it in my household? And you look at your household, you know why you can't get into it? Maybe the scriptures in there. What if I told you that today, for the first time for freedom, you can have a solution to the root of this problem? Maybe what if I told you that the root of this problem all to be dealt with what we're going to deal with today in the partition of the community? What if I told you that it could change your life, what we're going to be learning today? Would you be willing to listen? Would you be willing to sit still and say, you know what? I need to examine this and see what I can do to you. I believe in the Lord gave me this. He had to be in the mind. He knew what was going to happen today. He knew what was going to happen when those problems about having a problem with the things being broken off and strengthened. What if something that we had been taught and just religiously done for a long time and recovered the 3 years of what community was about and we missed something? What if we could have revelation today? Something that would change our life and change the sickness in our church. What if it could change the loss in our family? What if it could light a fire and everything that has been sanctified that has been divorced for a life and a years? Come in heaven, we're going to have the greatest move of God we've ever seen. Come in God, we're going to have the greatest God we've ever seen. Things are going to happen in 2013. Now we come to the place to realize that we serve a covenant God. Yes, he makes promises to us, and he says if we do certain things, then things will happen. You see, how can we have all these wonderful things happen for us if we just come out and sit in the body and not do our part? We're going to talk about a covenant God today, and not just any old man covenant God. We're going to talk about a great covenant God. Father God, I thank you that you are moving in this place already, that you are already here. Holy Spirit, I thank you that you are here and blind our eyes, you are unstopping in those words, God, that we are going to blind our eyes, that you come and dissolve your light in the hearts of men, that you come to give them revelation, that they will understand the things that you are saying to the church today. And I thank you for revelation, the spirit of wisdom, the spirit of knowledge, and the spirit of revelation on our people, that we will not leave this place unturned for God, that we will change and give them life. That your word will be established in our hearts and we receive revelation in Jesus' name. Amen. You see, the partaking of the body and the drinking of the blood was something that the disciples and the apostles really didn't get what they were doing. How many men that they were really doing and had revelation as Lord and Master of Jesus Christ, what happened to Jesus Christ on that cross? You think they would have had a little different mindset? If we stop and think about it, we have revelation of what they are actually partaking of. We have knowledge of what this thing is doing, but we don't have revelation. We don't fully understand. What if I told you, we got pretty good understanding of what the Bible really was? What if there's another part of those people that we have not gotten revelation of? And the only thing we do is to return the face of God and what's doing this for us around the world. Anybody realize things are getting more than the following area? You see how that is so opportunity for them to take out of this environment to lose. Let's say that Matthew 26, verse 26. Matthew 26, 26. What is that they were going to do? Jesus took some bread. And after blessing it, He broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Hey, this is my body." And when he had taken the cup to give and thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. For this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for forgiveness of sins. But I say to you," what does that mean? It's a continuation, isn't it? It's a continuation of the covenant. He says this, but then does this, right? So this is continuing on in the Bible. It's a Bible study of you. I will not drink of this fruit of the vine, for you have to tell the devil when I drink new with you in my Father's kingdom. When you get revelation that right now, when you are in the kingdom, who is in heaven, and he is the vine, and he is the one, and when we partake of him, we will take the communion with you now. This is a now statement. I'm not going to be able to do that. That word fruit is like, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine. That word fruit, fruit is the meaning offspring. Purity. King James is the same even translated generation. Are you seeing something here? We know that Jesus is the true vine, don't we? And we know that we are in the gospel. Amen. So maybe if God says, "Well, to draw out to drink of that, we can't get the sin that the flesh is deeper than what we've been partaking of." I wonder what that would be. Don't you? Maybe the flesh is deeper than what I draw out to draw out. Well, yeah, but you start talking about drink. The word vine comes from the word intellect. Vine are told about as a support. Jesus said, "Here's the vine, and he pulls it by the heart. He's going to be one to support us. We are his fruit, right?" What if I told you that you said that is fruit? But it's not God's will for you to stay for it, and you want you to be telling the Bible. Get better for it. What if I told you, maybe what he's talking about is discipleship here? He says, "Make me an ass." Let's go ahead and turn to John 15, verse 1. John 15, verse 1. He says, Has the vine dresser been in your vineyard, bearing more fruit on you? Has anybody felt any slip and taken away the word of God on you to the mountains? Why does it say that he's doing that? So we can bear more fruit. But what happens if we say, "No, don't be surrendered. God wants to bring my vine." The vine will die and we will not produce fruit. You see, I'm going to put some scriptures together this morning. Because you are already clean because the word which I have spoken to you. Abiding in me is all in me. The branch cannot bear the fruit of its fruit unless it abides in the vine. Abiding in communion is relationship. understand you and what you're bothering you. And I know why you are the answer. You have something to do with what you're doing, right? Can you hear that is in the news? Can you hear that? Can you hear that? Can you hear that? Can you hear that? This is not much fruit. I mean, I don't know.
We can call our voice and say, wait a second, this is the type of thing.
without God's glory in the fact that I'm not called to do that. We don't need to confess that so that we can see that God is the fact I'm not called to go out and witness and to do that. That is something we want to call the divine. We must understand we are called to do more than what we've been doing. We are called to do more than we've been doing. We are called to call different things we said that and be on this mode. And by calling on this mode, when you live a life without discipleship, you live in the deep mode and you do not walk in victory because you're getting bad. From spiritual fight to spiritual fight. And some of you may be on the spiritual fight today, you have a good service. Where is God here? Okay. What are we going to do with it? I'm sick of living in that dream body. Anybody want to see the new man? We're going to get attached to the body and double free as healthy bodies. And you need to get with that. You may get tired. And that may be painful at the time. Many of you may be experiencing pain now, but it brings you joy. Why does bringing new pain bring you joy right now? Because I know it caused you to get on my feet. That is my joy. The joy set before you was running in this world can help you to produce more fruit and time and the talent that God has made for you. So, what are you going to do with what happened to you today? You're going to use it because you are called to be the dangerous. But if you trust it, you will not walk in those things, but if you take it, and somebody says, you know what? God loves you. He put his hand on you. I will raise you up. I will disciple you so that you can go speak to the people that God has called you. And you're going to be so much more joyous. We have a calling. We have a calling. I know I know what I'm doing. What are we going to do with it? Who's going to take the baby? Who's going to take the baby and Christ together and say, you know what? I'm going to put my arm around you and I'm going to go with you and disciple you and raise you up to the man of God that God has called you to be, even if it's 10 times greater than what he's had to be. You see, that's what we were called to do. Why are we here? So we can learn how to be disciples so we can go and bring the life and disciple other people. This is not faith. This is not faith. They pray for us to come so you can just walk with the Holy Spirit, just build back and just exist. All is part of existence. God did not call you to just exist. He called you to be more than a conqueror. In Christ Jesus. That's what we are called to be. He says, what is your soul? Let's go to John 15, verse 12. I don't know that I'm the teacher today. I want to be a part of the pastor today, but I do feel the power that I do. Because he's talking about prayer and suffering that we want to escape from the fire. You can't simply, I want to say that I want to say that you just want to sit. We grow up in the church. I don't even try to think about if I'm not after giving the last person to how many people were paid. Disobedience causes people to pay, and we are called to greatness. He says, I have paid the price for you, but you have to fast for you spiritually. That is where he is wanting to worship you. He wants to fast for you spiritually, and that is going to be all about helping you to do spiritually. He can bless you. When we produce fruit, we receive His blessing. We say in John 15, 12, this is my commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that one lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. do as a commander. Not only do I call you strong for the things that don't matter what his master is doing, but I call you to me. For all things that I can tell you from my father, I have really learned to you. We need to make these very next point. It is very vital and important. You did not choose me, but I chose you. I told you that you would go to the fruit.
We are
doing the work for the kingdom. Why is there a lot of things doing stuff? He's trying to fruit. He has seen the fruit of the evangelism. And the joy and love, the powerful thing that's happening in the Indian community. The life that comes from it. The excitement. Do you want to follow me in the other day in life for these things? Are you ready to jump out of this family? Because you know what you want to do? covenant with you that we need to realize that we do not alone. That we are not alone. And if we want to benefit, we have to do it. We have to do it as if we are living alone. So, 1 Corinthians 6, verse 19. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 19. For do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you? Who we have from God, and that you are not your own, for you have been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. Are we going to have a glory body with our body? Or do we just do it right away during the church time? You see, we're called to be God's glory with our bodies and everything, whether we're working on it, we have to do it. Even at night, the things that we find all day long, whatever we do, we are called to bring to any glory. That doesn't mean you have to be chasing the world, but it means to be living the world as well. That's why we want to use the testimony of a life of love would be more good for the kingdom than all the words that we could prove for the kingdom of God. It's the lifestyle of love that brings people to God's glory. That you don't know something, you can speak the words of love and not even. You can tell the friends of scripture, they not even know it's a scripture, and they just think you're really smart. But it's the wisdom of God when you pour that through. That's why we need the word of God from the air. If it's really, if the word being said lines up with what God wants to say. But we are not alone. And we need to have the answer. We're not getting to that one day. I want to do this. This is my microphone. And God said, yeah, but my time is going to be here. You've got to let you get yourself out of the blessings and you're doing what you want to do instead of what you said you need to do. How can we reach the ones that we're supposed to reach? Because we're not going to be able to do it. We're supposed to be able to do it for the cause of somebody. And God said, you know what? But there's a mercy here in order to do it. How would you play the cause of God? Just telling me that somebody has it forgotten. In time to dream, I heard about the prophecies that were working on ministry over this church. And I know that there are some people that do visit. But is it to the level that God desires it to be? I believe that. I believe it's going to be. I believe that. There's people that that live their lives and that people have forgotten about, that have fallen away from Christ and they become bitter. When people find out they're sitting, they're unloved, and they're full of those children that they desire to still love and they have not, that they've not been forgotten. Never do you have hope. I've worked in the nursing homes, and it's probably the most hopeless place I've ever been to such a death row. You know what I'm saying? This is a fear that lacks hope in this nursing home. And we're people who have hope. You know, they don't turn around before they step out. They step into the beginning of the day and start. But are they going? You got to do the works of the Lord. In Philippians 3:7, that whatever things we're going to need, those things are going to come into the world for the sake of Christ. More than that, it's not all things to be lost in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things. And tell him that it, so that I may gain Christ and be found in him. You know what? We're talking about that value, Christ's relationship. Being found in him again. He goes back to that. It's what it is in this. That we define it here, define it in writing, not merely the righteousness of my own derived from the law, but that we can through faith in heaven. The righteousness was come from God on the basis of faith. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering. Being conformed to his death in order that I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Ministries, this is another part of the ministry. That we would know him and the power of his resurrection. And the fellowship of this suffering. But my question is, are we being conformed into his death so that we can have life? He has routinely died for all our wills and our desires. is what happened behind the scripts in the verses. How can we hold it when we've got in victory? Wouldn't you like people to stand and imagine when we've got in victory so that we can pass through this time and we've lived with liberty and all of the objectives, taking credit for the kingdom of heaven, and having his brothers that can pass through the Bible, that can pass the Bible through years? I'm tired of running from the Bible. We need to experience it. And we're sad if you come up and say, I'm going to keep up with my own idea. You know, God says, you tell me that, right? You tell me that was scripture. We're doing what I need to do. We need to have a new body. We need all part of the body, all part of the covenant. You see, God's looking for the selfless praise, giving the Father's word and love. That's what God is wanting to do. He's wanting us to do His work and His will. He loves us. So that when we partake of the body, when we partake of the blood, because we're making this covenant, as we partake of these things, we're making covenant that we can have a free will to conform us into His image, so that we will do His will. So that we can take this and throw it back to the very beginning. When we talk about the fruit of the vine and the branches and the covenant that Jesus was talking about, every time we come close to this, we're renewing our covenant with Him, that we're going to do His will and do about His will, His business, the Father's business. The Word says, when Jesus returns, He's going to make us see those who are so holy. Who are the Father's business? We've got to be about the Father's business, then we're going to be about it if we want to be about the Father's business. And today, I'm going to say to you, if you don't know how to disciple, or if you don't know, find someone who does. And that's the new disciple you will hear. Now, we have some great Bible studies on Tuesday mornings. We do Bible work. We get certain here. But you know what I'm saying? There's so much more to it with the one and the only discipleship. Because there's accountability. When you have one-on-one discipleship, there's accountability. The one thing that the Bible lacks is accountability. Who did He give accountability to? We need to be willing to be accountable with somebody. When you make that covenant, we're making a covenant to a brother and sister, the man and the woman. We make that covenant, we make a covenant that we will allow the bond of His covenant, just unbound it. That we will allow Him to do the work here so that we can produce the fruit, the great amount of fruit, the massive amount of fruit that He wants to produce. You see, if we are doing the great thing we're supposed to do in our covenant relationship, this place will not be a fish. It will be full. See, before we consider the things, we got to step up and do what our bodies do so that we can handle the increase. Who gives the increase? What is that good for you? For you to learn. And who gives the increase? You know, that's something you can sell and learn and you can learn all you want and get a foot. We're coming to next week, we get saved and ready. We're following, saved and ready. How can we get the increase unless we get a step up and run some corners on it? That's where we're coming in. We do know that the disciples of all, that we were to take care of that skill of that data, that stuff on the way that they made them call it and the disciples, and they could not only become those believers. Because if we believe we will do what Jesus said, we will do what He said. We need to come to a place where we are believing, and believing is actually doing. Putting our faith to work, not for anyone, doing things that we can do our faith. You see, the one thing that can really be when we examine ourselves, we look for the things of commission. Have I won the fight for anything? Have I lost my temper? Have I done this and have I done that? We always look at the things of commission and we examine. But today, I believe God is wanting us, and every day, God is wanting us to challenge ourselves to look at the sins of omission. The sins of omission. Where does the word say that we're supposed to do something, and we didn't do it, so we don't reap the benefits, and we remind God of what He promised, but we don't reap it what He told us we need to do. You see, that thing we're missing is one thing that has hurt the body. You know what I'm saying? The Bible says that if we have these sins, they're falling in a household. Right? And the Bible, what do you say to these people today? They got disciples and they had to be disciples. That was the thing that these people say. They were not in the wrong way. So, if we would be saved and go out and live the life, then our household would be. We want to find the fact that we've got to stop being in our planet. We've got to stop putting some food on the bottle and being in nursing homes. 1 Corinthians 11:27. Therefore, whoever eats the bread and drinks of the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But a man must examine himself in surgery to make the eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats surgery and eats the bread, judgment to himself, if he does not judge the body rightly. Now, if you know, there's a period of my family, my first photo, there's a continuation, to be used with what? Because I'm eating and drinking, I'm wondering, because and then you go to the Bible, it says, for this reason, you are not only are rich and sick, but are never free. What is the condition of the church in America? How many sickness and disease do we have in the church? How many people are sleeping in the church in America? What has happened to discipleship in the churches? What has happened to all that is in the Bible and in the Bible? And he says, if we do not have the same most popular, that you will find rich people and sick people and sleeping people. We talked about the cure. We talked about the cure. The cure is being obedient to God and being discipleship and discipling the way He called the early church to be. You see, the cure of missing, the one thing that we have been missing is we say, you know what? I want to lay my word down and I want to be used by the Lord the way He wants me to be used. And it's tough out here. We can repent and that's great, but we've got to change. We've got to say, you know, I'm going to be disciples and I'm going to be happy disciples. I'm going to let my eyes get on the bed and help him to receive the calling and say, oh, no, he's gone before I take him. We have to be looked at. We have to come into that place where we want to see people who meet the calling in their lives. There's many people in here that are called to serve the Lord, and they just need to be told, they need to raise up and spread out to do a mighty work for the Lord. And if we do that, we can partake of it and we can be sharing it even without that sin of omission. You see, we have to have a sickness in the body in here, but we have to be saying that He is the body. He's the true body. There is a body dressing in the room today. That we are the bodies, and it is required that we bear much fruit that remains. And the remaining part of it is someone has to be taken. It's all part of the covenant deal. It's all part of it. And why do we do that? Because discipleship has been lost in the church. When God said to me that I needed to do it, I was taken back. I couldn't say that. Why do we always have so many sick people in our presence? They never say that. We never believe this. We never believe this. Why do we go? Why do we probably do things that are sick and sick and sick? Why are we not sick and sick and sick and sick and sick and sick? When we just say it carefully, when we partake of it, get rid of the sin of omission and start becoming disciples. The one that we do in the book of Acts. If you stop and think about it, the book of Acts, and the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came, we'd be able to be the disciples that day. How long? How long? And immediately the kingdom was being Jesus and the kingdom of the living Jesus that brings back the heart of discipleship. We need to know ourselves, the extremity of the life, and we put on the target commitment of what is on your life. We need more persecuted, but we understood that they were not the one, but they were called to do the Lord's work. We are all ambassadors for the Lord. We are all called to do it. The question is, when we partake of this, are we going to be rightly defended? To get rid of the sin of our nature. We need to defend these things properly. And these people in the world today that said, you know what, I follow the Lord. These many people in the world today that said, you know, I follow the Lord. I find myself getting this wrong from that.
Thank you.